And then we created some dioramas. I've always been fascinated by these little miniature scenes. They used to be in Madame Tussauds when I was a kid, and I was always intrigued by them, battle scenes. And so we've tried to put pieces that we thought were particularly apt. Here, a Tanzanite locket with Virginia Woolf in it, appropriately at the bottom of the lake. And then here, the ultimate boy's toy, I suppose, a beautifully made silver locomotive in its own little scene. And I think, again, focuses the eye on the detail and on it being part of something wider than just a lump of metal, really. And here, a bamboo ring, probably worn by a camp commandant who's died on the way escaping through the jungle. And this kind of fairy scene, there was a painter called Dad who went mad, in fact, who killed his father, ironically, who did these extraordinary little paintings, and this really was the influence for these fairy pieces. We've made enough Marmite, Liz, to sink a battleship, I suppose, and one has to embrace the fact that it's been one of the things that we're known for, so we just thought a 5-foot-high one would show that. The cobra holding the cobra key was put down in this sort of strange gallery, like a squash court kind of thing, and we put some telescopes there so people could look at it maybe 25 foot away. So they looked through the telescope and they really, really looked at the piece of jewellery. In a way, funnily enough, they never would have done had it been straight and crooked. It was interesting to watch. Well, as you come into the darker room, and I suppose it's a darker room both physically and in sort of emotion, the first thing here is the electric chair, and the lady is wearing this fabulous Pariba ring. It's an extraordinary stone. Has this electric, appropriately neon look to it. And it's the last thing she'll ever see and the last thing she'll ever wear. Again, more of these dioramas, this time slightly more, slightly darker in mood. And I hope also allowing people to look at the detail of, for instance, the snake. Unbelievable piece of craftsmanship, a fantastic setting. And I hope these little dioramas, these little installations will get people to focus on the actual piece and understand what's in it and how it's come to be. And here these scars, which we've been making for, God, nearly 30 years, I guess, one way or the other. Just thought we'd hide one or two of the rings amongst the labyrinth.
Another cartoon, please.
And then here, the scorpion ring. This is part of a thing that we called an imperial collection, which is 5 pieces, but all with different stones and different permutations of gold and surround. So this one is an amethyst, there was a tanzanite, I think there was a yellow beryl one. And this, the cross for which we seem to have become quite well known, I've never really seen it as having much in the way of religious iconography, but it's difficult to escape that. And so we put it in a churchyard to show one of its varieties. And here a pair of chalices, really, really beautifully made, obviously with a very medieval feel to them. And really these were a sort of tour de force, and we wanted to show that this kind of craftsmanship is still alive, and so we designed it to as a showcase for those great craftsmen. And Paul Quasimodo, probably the most romantic figure that ever lived, and a monument to the fact that you don't have to be good-looking to be romantic, and you can still be ugly and get away with great jewelry. And this really is all that's left. When first we were going to do this, we were going to call it All That's Left, because it is all that's left. And here's a guy shot, and the bullet has your name on it. But it was the kind of idea that skeletons dug up would be just rancid bones, and on top of them would be the jewelry, pretty much as it would have been the day the wearer died. Just one more ship. And then here, a bat ring again, one of the poison rings that opens up, and inside that can go a baby's tears or a lover's breath, who knows. But pitched in a little castle opposite, I think, Dracula's castle. And then with this mannequin, we tried to recreate an ad we'd done earlier in the year, which was a sort of film noir, very shady, shadowy picture with the salamander pendant on it, and I think it's worked very well, and it attracted a lot of attention. People almost sensed that it was a real woman. And then these are some smoke pictures done by Michael Fennell, not my love child as people have thought, but a very, very fine Cumbrian artist, and he does these with tallow smoke. It's a technique that's been going for 500 or 600 years, and he's perfected it, revived it even. And it was to take some of our heroines and put great jewelry on, so that someone like Kay Kendall here, who I've been in love with since I was probably 12, is actually wearing the piece of jewelry that I've designed here. And these are two black salamanders playing around a really gorgeous mandarin garnet. Great piece of craftsmanship. And I think it has this resonance where you see somebody who's quite patently from the past wearing something very contemporary. And here we have Amelia Earhart wearing the ring that is an homage to her. And we call it the Lost Flyer. Carved in mammoth bone and just beautifully made, just a wonderful piece of craftsmanship. So in the penultimate room, we wanted to entertain a bit here, the seaside cutouts that you put your head through and have yourself photographed wearing jewelry, and some little ideas that perhaps acted as a catalyst to think about jewelry in a different way. This Cluedo set with all the murder implements with the candlestick up in the top, just a little bit of a different way of showing something. And the pirate ship, just a fantastic piece of silversmithing. I can be immodest about the craftsmanship because it's not me that makes them. I design them, and these incredible craftsmen, many of whom have worked for me for 20, 25 years, put them together, and it's a fabulous thought that these kind of skills are still around, that there are still people who can make these things. And it's a pleasure working with them. And this was just a way of showing some of the bug jewelry we do, little scarab here, little brooch, enameled and stone set. Bit of fun set up there in a kind of a bug picture. Those things used to terrify the life out of me when I was a kid. I used to go into these museums to see these things, and I had this terrible feeling they were all going to suddenly come to life and burst out of the frame. But enough of my traumatized childhood. Again, this was just a bit of fun, but somebody actually came up, a little lady came up to me and complained that something had been stolen, and she was beside herself with fright. The time is now. these exhibits should show just how much goes into any one proper piece of jewellery, from the design and the concept through to the craftsmanship and the realisation. Out of control. And this was a Hakusai ring. It sort of shows the breadth of inspiration, the breadth of references that I like to use. I like the idea of those very lean Japanese pictures. And urban rage. And the point of these was to try and find something that was lean enough to frame them without overpowering the stone. And it's sometimes more difficult to do something minimalist and understated, just to hold a great stone, than it is to go over the top and do something theatrical and clever. Life. The telephone box is something we've done for years. We've done telephone box sugar shakers, and we just thought we should put a telephone box in a telephone box in a telephone box. So here's a guy I saw on Dragon's Den with an absurd notion called the phony box. And so we rang him up and said, can you make them a silver? And here it is. Ring the final phase, exchanging all our yesterday. Surprisingly, a lot of jewellery is defined by not being there, by its loss. All of us have got bits of jewellery or know people who had bits of jewellery that they love that they've lost, that they've had stolen, they've mislaid. And wherever you are, probably in the world, you're near a piece of jewellery, like being near a rat in London. I think there's going to be a piece of jewellery under you or by you or down the seat you're sitting in. It's just a strange thing. And lots of the pieces that people loved and that we all loved have gone. And they could be languishing in a field, on a beach, in the snow, and maybe not far away from you. We wanted to do a red carpet piece, as they're called, something that you could be seen going to a first night or a premiere in, but in this case you'd have to walk backwards because it goes at the back of the head. And I rather like the idea of some huge star wandering down the red carpet with no jewellery at all, and it was only after she'd gone past the cameras that everybody realised that the really wonderful piece of jewellery was on the back of her head. Well, that's what it comes to. The gurney, where we've shuffled off this mortal coil, the tag on the toe will come to us all. Luckily, this particular Fennell died of laughter at 105. Well, that may not be all, because we may get a second bite at the cherry, and this is our little version of heaven with the angel's dressing table, and I hope with the drawer opening to show the ruby heart with the horns, that jewellery should always have some quirkiness. Sometimes it should have some humour, sometimes it's probably too important to have humour, but it should always engage, and I hope this show is as amused.